The dumper who deliberately poured oil into a stormwater drain in Newcastle last May has never been caught by authorities, who believe he may be a regular offender. It's possible that people may have witnessed the dumping but weren't sure how to report it. Newcastle Council believes the same may be true for many similar incidents.
I think a lot of people say, oh, well, someone else will report it, or someone else will do about it, or they have the attitude that nothing will happen if they do report it.
Council's Health and Building section has prepared leaflets to be distributed throughout the city, giving emergency numbers to report air or water pollution or rubbish dumping. The Environmental Protection Unit isn't always the body that can deal with the problem, but it can alert the right people. Health and Building Surveyor Harold Stewart says the team isn't after the big industrial producers who are covered by state pollution control licences.
A lot of the pollution that occurs are really the backyard industries and ordinary people who either don't understand or don't want to understand that, pouring a couple of gallons of sump oil down a stormwater drain is a problem to the environment.
And it's expected that from tonight, council officers will have new powers to issue on-the-spot fines for minor pollution offences. The target will be small-scale noise and air pollution, such as backyard burning or troublesome car alarms. But council's real targets are the deliberate dumpers. For them, it's the Land and Environment Court and penalties of up to $1 million. Tom Hilston, NBN News.
Newcastle has one of the richest maritime traditions in Australia, but the region's maritime museum is worried that much of that history is crumbling away or could sink without a trace. To help raise funds needed to restore artefacts, the museum today briefed its major sponsors on the projects it's planning for next year.
The major one, as far as the museum is concerned, is the enclosure of the boat shed. And that's vitally important this year because the artefacts inside that shed are deteriorating.
Ms. Linnell says other major projects include the computer cataloguing of the museum's 5,000 photos and a shipwreck walk along both breakwaters. The museum's biggest fundraising event is its annual Harbour Regatta. This maritime extravaganza keeps rewriting its own history books by breaking attendance records and adding new events such as the Formula One powerboat races. The regatta's 1992 logo was unveiled today. Ms. Linnell says the regatta not only raises funds, it puts Newcastle in touch with its links with the sea.
This tiny van has been home for Lynn Bush and her four children since 1987. Other residents have lived on the site for more than 10 years. They pay between $40 and $60 per week, but new state government legislation will stop that.
We've either got to move away or rent something, which we can't afford to do.
The legislation states parks have to be of a certain standard, including water and sewage facilities for each unit, plus cement pads for the vans. The caravan park is in a flood-prone area, and council has decided it would simply be unrealistic to revamp the site. A spokesman said alternative areas are being checked, but there is a problem with finances. No money has been allocated, and it's estimated more than $200,000 is needed to build an approved park. Meanwhile, the residents, which include pensioners, are anxious about their future. They say they can't afford to rent.
So if they can't get a house, where do they go?
You tell me. We need houses. We need help. This is our home. We want to stay here.
The residents have until April next year to move out. Council says that deadline can be extended. Peter Ryan, NBN News. Most people would think farm work is healthy and safe, but behind the image is a great danger. In the last 4 years, there were 665 farm-related accidents in the Hunter alone, figures that shock even the experts.
I just thought the figures were quite staggering, and I didn't expect there to be so many, because I've always believed country life to be fairly easy and sort of carefree.
The tractor is the greatest killer from 1985 to 1989. 22 people died in the Hunter when their machine toppled over. Encouragingly, there have been no deaths since. That's been put down to education and legislation making roll bars compulsory. The greatest cause of non-fatal accidents is horse riding, more than 120 accidents locally each year. Mostly head injuries, riders too complacent to wear a helmet.
I think that they are aware of them, just that they don't think that it'll happen to them.
Safety experts say keeping injury free is mostly common sense. It's just sometimes we need to be reminded.
The 44-year-old woman was driving her late model Holden sedan out of the Cardiff Bowling Club's car park at about 20 to 5 when she collided with another vehicle. Her car was spun around, and with the throttle wide open, she drove back into the car park. Andrew Ashby witnessed the woman's unsuccessful attempts to halt the car.
I think the throttle got stuck. We come down here and tried to skid it out to stop it.
It's believed the car careered through a fence, jumped a dry creek bed and ploughed onto an oval before stopping. After being trapped for a short time, the woman was released by police rescue and ambulance officers and taken to John Hunter Hospital with a fractured thigh. The driver of the car hit at the outset of the drama was also taken to John Hunter Hospital with minor injuries. Scott Bevan, NBN News.
Between them, this trio has sired some of Australia's best racehorses, with prize money totalling more than $40 million. 21-year-old Lunchtime has a reputation as one of Australia's most consistent sires, while stablemate Bletchingly, also 21 today, has been the Australasian champion sire three times, fathering greats including Melbourne Cup winner Kingston Town and a selection of Golden Slipper winners. An inspiration to both birthday boys is 25-year-old veteran Vane. One of the greatest sires to stand in Australia, Vane is also hailed as one of our best gallopers.
He's a champion. Champion, that's all I can say. 12 out of 14 races, and he won them all easily. He was a champion.
Oh, he's something special. I've never ridden a horse as good as him. Naturally, he was a sprinter, and I've ridden some very good stayers. But all in all, he rates as by far the best horse I rode.
High praise indeed from a man who's ridden about 2,400 races and won the Melbourne and Caulfield Cups and the Golden Slipper. But you can have praise any day, but not birthday cake.
Happy birthday.
But who wants cake when you can have a camera?
Mr. Welsh was in Charlestown this afternoon to officiate at the launching of the 1,000th Beat Police Patrol in the state. He believes the new rates legislation will be introduced into state parliament in the September session. Under the rating structure, everyone would pay a flat amount for services plus a percentage on valuation.
Well, the flat rate would take into account more equitable payment for the services provided. The 40% increment would be on the value of the property as it is now.
Lake Macquarie has been the scene of heated debate over the existing rating structure, which has seen valuation-based rates soar in prime localities despite a real estate downswing. Other less desirable locations had felt only a fraction of the increase, a system Mr. Welsh says is inequitable.
There's no rhyme or reason for the charges. It doesn't relate to the services they receive, and I think some people are being more heavily taxed, more heavily burdened than others.
Thank you. Bishop Holland has been in charge of the Diocese of Newcastle for almost 14 years. Although it's customary for bishops to retire at age 70, 64-year-old Bishop Holland believes the time for him is right now.
Being 14 years as the Bishop of Newcastle is a demanding task, and I think really going into the last decade, it would be good to have a new, perhaps younger leader with new ideas, new gifts. I think that's right for the diocese. I think it's right for me too.
Bishop Holland will officially step down this time next year, so he says he has plenty of time to decide what he wants to do. Influencing his decision, though, is a job offer overseas, one the bishop would not elaborate on. The Anglican Senate has a year to find someone to take over as Bishop of Newcastle, a job which, according to Bishop Holland, is becoming very demanding.
I think we've got an incredible spiritual vacuum. I think we've got a people who feel apathetic and complacent simply because they're not being given the proper leadership from politicians, I might add. They seem to be more interested in their own party political machines, more interested in their leadership aspirations, more interested in winning the next election.
After weeks of speculation, the state government's decision hardly came as a shock. Despite the board's last-ditch effort to avert the axe by a proposal for revamping of the services, it was to no avail.
The Minister for Hospital Services, Ron Phillips, reviewed the board's rescue package, but the diagnosis was not good. Today, the Chief Executive Officer, Owen James, and the board of the Hunter Area Health Service were dismissed.
We've come up with a litany of management control problems, and the board has shown itself unable to come to grips with what needs to happen to put in a good management team and to bring under control the financial hemorrhaging that's occurring in the Hunter.
The minister said one of his most serious concerns was the discovery of an audit that nearly $3 million of public money was improperly diverted by the Area Health Service for its own use through a separate set of handwritten ledgers. While there was no evidence of personal gain, the Health Department and Treasury viewed it seriously. The money consisted of interest on funds paid to the area, which the minister said should have been returned to Treasury.
We had to put in car parks in John Hunter, which were unable to be funded in any other way. We needed an amenities block. We were unable to refurbish buildings, lacking what we call an RMR, repair, maintenance and renewal line item.
Mr. Phillips said other areas of concern included the board's inability to pay $2.5 million to local creditors, massive overstaffing at three Newcastle hospitals, $3 million in overstocking by the logistics support unit, overspending on the laundry contract, and the board's discovery in June that it was $5 million over budget last year when it told the department in April that it was on budget.
Is that financial mismanagement?
Yeah, sure, sure. Yeah, and I'm responsible for it because there should have been sufficient, in the case of stock, impressed management, in the case of the hospital's payroll forgetting, there should have been in place, in the case of also the recruiting, adherence to the board's directions.
On the question of underfunding, the board says more money is required for the Hunter, but the minister disagrees. He has appointed a new administrator, Dr. Timothy Smythe. He will oversee the changes to the Hunter's health service. At 3 o'clock this afternoon, the executive officer of the Walls End Hospital told staff their hospital will be closed.
The representatives from the Department of Health have acknowledged that we're a very cost-efficient hospital and we provide an excellent service. But they see that we are located very close to the new John Hunter Teaching Hospital and, as I say, our future wasn't to be.
For catering officer Neville Austin, who has been employed at the hospital for 46 years, the news was distressing.
I don't know. Just upset.
Thank you.
It's been a tough introduction to the Winfield Cup first grade for new coach David Waite, yet to taste success after four outings. But the feeling in the camp is high, and in the matches against Cronulla and Balmain, they frittered away a handy half-time lead to be finally overrun. Now in 14th position on the ladder and 1 point behind the Rabbitohs, the players have vowed to return the club to the winners list on Sunday to herald in a new era for the Knights.
We'd like to get off on the right foot. I think with the announcement having been made that things will be more settled at the club, and we know where we're heading. So hopefully if we start with a win, we'll be heading in the right direction.
But the Rabbits won't be any pushover, showing enough late last year to signal a return to better days. And this year they have done that, albeit in a small way, and last week gave the Premiership favourites a fright before going under. Equally, the Newcastle Falcons are after their first win for a while, 15 matches to be exact, when they tackle the informed Gold Coast Rollers tomorrow night. The Rollers and the Falcons have met on three previous occasions, with the Gold Coast winning each encounter by 3 points. The visitors are in third position on the ladder, and with Mike Mitchell in brilliant form, will be a huge hurdle for the Falcons at Broadmeadow.
Dr. Timothy Smythe is quick to shrug off the perception held by some that he's here from Sydney to carry out a hatchet job.
I think they'll be pleasantly surprised. I don't have hidden agendas, and I'm anxious to meet with the industrial associations as soon as possible so they can put a face to the name, and I'm confident that we'll be able to work something out.
Dr. Smythe holds degrees in medicine and law, as well as mastering in business administration. He's officially here on 6 months' secondment from his administrator's role at St George Hospital at Cogra to restore the government's faith in the area health service. Central to that task will be the planned closure of Walls End Hospital and the redistribution of its equipment and staff.
Well, I think the issue about job losses is something that is the last thing we're looking at. What I'm looking at is redistributing the services and as much as possible identifying vacancies that we can place staff into. There is a voluntary redundancy package that is being offered, and that I'm sure a number of staff will be anxious to take up, and I think issues about retrenchments are not on the agenda at the present time.
That's cold comfort to the more than 500 employed at the hospital who made their feelings plain today, as did members of the community whose livelihoods have also been built around the hospital.
It means a big part of our business is going to disappear. We supply the papers for to the patients and the lunches and lollies and with the trolley that goes around twice a day.
We're going to lose a lot of business and a lot of friends as well from the hospital.
Concern is shared by civic leaders.
What damage are they going to do to our suburb of Walls End by ripping a hospital that we rely on for many, many things? Half the traders in Walls End rely in some way on that hospital.
Meanwhile, a not-so-bitter pill to swallow was last night's launch of Medical Research Week, upset only by the inability of the Education Minister, Virginia Chadwick, to perform the official opening. While she did provide a written address, the Minister blamed her absence on a prior engagement.
Our official opener, Mrs. Virginia Chadwick, the Minister for Education, had been unable to make it up here tonight.
The theme is the contribution of medical research to women's health. Andrew Lobb reporting for NBN News.
The pleasures and challenges of horse riding have long been recognised for their role in the rehabilitation of disabled children, but the most important role of all is providing the novice riders with a goal. And today they are treated to a thrilling display by dedicated riders who showed there's no limit to enthusiasm. Jamie Hudson on Traveller Josie demonstrated Western pleasure riding, while Brooke Lawrence on an A-grade show jumper Royal Blue put on a display of blindfolded hacking and, just for finishers, a couple of jumps without a bridle. The day included a number of integrated riding events, and to finish off the Gymkhana, a return to the age of horsepower with a ride in a Cobb & Co. coach.
It was all there for the curious and the canny, right down to the candelabra. There was something for those with an eye for the old and the valuable. Jewellery and furniture is highly sought after, while other items such as this 1930s Graflex camera touch on a soft spot for collectors. Valuers were kept busy but noted a word of caution for those who might be considering selling off the family heirlooms during the tough times.
But we try not to hurt the people too much, and we just explain that it's, although it's in Great Granny's family, it's not worth a lot of money. It's a decorative item of the 1920s, 1900s.
Nobby Signal Station received a call at about 3 o'clock from the Greek bulk carrier Leah at anchor a few kilometres off the coast. A crewman working in the engine room had been knocked off balance and fallen heavily among machinery. The helicopter was called to airlift the 30-year-old seaman to the John Hunter Hospital, where he is now reported to be in a satisfactory condition.
The Falcons were chasing their first win in 15 appearances, and they opened well. Michael Johnson found space and dropped a long shot. Mike Mitchell pegged back the Falcons' lead with a big dunk. And the Rollers combined brilliantly to take a one-point march on the Falcons. Bullock was playing a loaned hand for the locals to keep them in touch early in the second quarter. But then Ron Ratliff stole the show and the Gold Coast were on a roll. They continued to play team basketball to open a 12-point lead and closed out the match with two steals, one resulting in a big three-pointer to Bailey, and the second nailed the win. Final score, Gold Coast 112, Newcastle 96.
About 8 o'clock, the Sunday morning serenity at Sunshine Point was disturbed by the sound of a gyrocopter in trouble.
I was sitting on the veranda, just to live a few doors up, and I saw the gyrocopter come around by the shore. And then I was looking at it, and it made a turn around following the lake, and the next thing there was a big bang.
The pilot, from the lakeside suburb of Balcollen, ditched the craft into less than 2 metres of water near the shore. Eyewitnesses who rushed to help thought he was in danger of drowning.
You know, he was under for quite a long time and all we could see was the top of his helmet and his arms waving everywhere, and, you know, we thought he couldn't get out. And then after a while he just come up and he said, you know, he had troubles undoing the seatbelt.
The smashed gyrocopter was pulled ashore with ropes. Once on dry ground, the pilot walked away uninjured.